Jenny Macklin, welcome.
Thank you, Chris.
Should families get government subsidised childcare if they're not working?
I think the important thing is to remember that when you're assessing childcare policy, you think of the huge range of different working lives that families have. So, of course, childcare is there to support families when they're working, but there are many families who are working very casual jobs, short shifts, part-time work, and we have to make sure that those families aren't excluded from childcare. The childcare sector is worried that about 100,000 families could be excluded by these changes. Now, we'll have to wait and see. But we want to make sure that childcare is affordable, accessible, but also there for children when they really need it.
But as a principal, if someone chooses not to work, should they get childcare benefits?
Well, it's not a matter of... That's the point I'm trying to make. The real issue is, will the government's policy meet the needs of families who have small amounts of work, irregular work, parents who are looking for work, who need, of course, access to childcare while they're looking for work, while they're studying? And we also have to remember, for very vulnerable children, how important childcare can be for them. So all of those things are going to be have to be looked at.
Yeah, I guess it boils down to a principle, though. Is this a welfare payment? Is it a payment for workforce participation? Or is it some kind of default position where the Commonwealth becomes the provider of early childhood education, which was never the Commonwealth's role?
Well, I think it actually always has been partly the Commonwealth's role. It's a shared responsibility with the states. We have preschools and kinders that are funded largely by the states, with the Commonwealth making a contribution. As we saw today, one of the good things that's happened over the last 5 years is that the Commonwealth is paying for extra access to preschool and kindergarten, one of the policies I was really pleased to be part of. We've seen a huge increase in early childhood education because of that policy. So the Commonwealth is involved. All the evidence shows that childcare and early education is great for kids. So let's remember that objective, as well as supporting parents who work.
OK, so if you see a package, though, which does help low and middle income families and which improves the position where parents are now, will you support it? And that will mean that you'll have to back the getting rid of some of the family benefits payments that you're holding up in the Senate.
Well, there's a lot of questions in all of that. First and foremost...
Will you help fund the package? Is basically it.
Let's go to each of those issues. First and foremost, of course, we want a childcare system that's good for parents and good for children. And we'll look at both of those perspectives, helping working parents, but also making sure that it's good for early education. We'll make sure also that when we assess the impact of the whole change, which families are going to be better off? How many families are going to be worse off? And what we know from the government's cuts in last year's budget is that a lot of families, millions of families, in fact, would be worse off. The government wants to cut family tax benefit Part B to those families who have a child. Once the youngest child turns six, they're off that payment. For some families, this is going to mean a cut of up to $6,000 a year. Now, we are not going to support that.
The $6 or $7 billion that are being held up, obviously, if you get a better package, it needs to be funded somehow. You wouldn't keep part of the old system and apply a new system. Surely you'd look at whether or not you would support this.
We'll certainly look at whether or not we'll support the improvements to the childcare system if they're good for parents and if they're good for children. That'll be the test. But what we won't do is say that one group of families is going to lose up to $6,000 a year for a single income family with a couple of children at school. That's what that family will lose. We're not going to support robbing Peter to pay Paul. That is just very short-sighted.
Can we go to the other end of the spectrum now and to pensions? Should people who have $1 million over and above the family home be getting a part pension?
Now, of course, like you, we've seen all this speculation, but nobody knows what the government's actually going to do, except one thing seems to be sure: they're going to break their promise again. Tony Abbott said to pensioners before the last election there would be no changes to pensions.
But you want them to break their promise on indexation now. You want them to break
No.
You said there'd be no change, sure, but you want them to break what they did last year, to change that.
Well, go back to what Tony Abbott said before the election. He said no changes to pensions. He broke that promise in last year's budget with a huge change to pension indexation. $80 a week cut to pensioners over the next decade. Yes, that should come out of the Parliament.
Sure, and I think we've heard all of that, but could we go to...
Well, it's not out of the Parliament yet.
We can go to what you might do, and do you think that people who have $1 million over and above the family home should be getting a part pension?
Well, we've indicated quite recently what we think needs to be done with the sustainability of the whole retirement income system. And so you've seen our priority from Bill Shorten and Chris Bowen, where we've really emphasised the importance of cutting back on some of the concessions to very high income earners.
Which gets you just over $1 billion a year, and you're looking at a $40 billion budget deficit
well,
this year.
Actually about $14 billion over the next 10 years.
So we've also $1.4 billion a year.
And we've also announced that we would crack down on those multinational corporations not paying their fair share of tax, another $7 billion. So we've said to the government, if you're looking for fair savings, take these ideas from Labor. Don't go to pensioners and try and whack those people, as they did in last year's budget, who are living on incomes as low as $20,000 a year.
Do you concede that you have to make savings at all in this area, given that pensions are 10% of the budget, welfare payments are 40% of the budget, it's growing at 20% a year over the next 4 years? Surely some change has to be made.
We did make some very significant changes when we were in government, and they were fundamentally to improve the adequacy of the pension. I think that this is very important to remember. There are millions of Australian pensioners living on a very small amount of money, around $20,000 a year. For me, the priority is to make sure we look after those people, and that people at the top who are on very large superannuation returns, they're the ones who should be making greater contribution.
Can I take you to a discussion this week within the Labor Party as you head towards July's national conference? Do you support getting rid of the conscience vote on gay marriage?
I do, and that's the way I voted, and many of my colleagues voted at the last national conference. And I think the good thing is that this is being openly debated. We'll have a good discussion about it in the lead up to national conference. I'm sure there'll be many people will put their different points of view, but it's a good thing the Labor Party parties having the debate.
So you're going to remove the conscience vote in the Labor Party and in the same breath and in the same breath you're going to argue that Tony Abbott should give one to the coalition. How does that add up?
Well, just let's take each of those questions separately as well. I do think that marriage equality should be delivered in Australia. That's the first principled position. Should people be treated equally? Yes, I think they should. I don't think Australians believe in inequality on the basis of race or gender, and I don't think we should do so on the basis of sexual preference. So that's the principle, and that's why I think it should be a binding issue. But these matters will be debated in the conference. Which way
when
it
you
goes
argue
is...
that you're arguing that a person who disagrees with you on this is the same as a racist, that they're a bigot.
Well, I'm not calling anybody names. I'm saying...
That's the natural extension of what you're saying,
no,
though,
isn't it? No, it's not. I'm not about to call anybody names. I'm saying these are matters of principle. I understand people have a different point of view. They'll have their opportunity to put their ideas forward, and so will we.
Sure, and if they have a different point of view, why can't they keep the conscience vote?
Well, we in the Labor Party have very strong views about discrimination. We've taken those views forward over many, many years, and I'm sure it'll be a productive debate.
Jenny Macklin, thank you.
Thank you.